chair is very close to the banner. If you want to, like, follow the bouncing ball and stick with us, the whole storytelling, which will be about an hour, come on up. Bring your food, bring your kids, bring your beverages. It's great. And if you can't see what I'm saying here, you should look. So nice. People I know and people I don't know all together. So, just so I understand, have you all seen this poster presented before?
No.
Okay. Awesome. So this is called The True Cost of Coal, and it's kind of like a gigantic love letter in pictures. Another way of thinking about it is it's a comic book that threw up all over one piece of paper. Another way of thinking about it is it's a map that shows us the overlaps and intersections of what's going on ecologically, socially, economically, spiritually, politically, and physically in the Appalachian Mountains, where mountaintop removal and other forms of extraction are devastating a region and its people. And why are we sharing this tool at an action camp that's about fracking? Well, as I'm sure folks have been discussing all weekend, there are a bunch of overlaps between the story of what's happening with coal extraction all over the world and here in this region, and what's going on with gas. Maybe even more importantly for me, this is a tool for storytelling, and it's a tool that we in the Beehive Collective use to do outreach all over the hemisphere with people who are not yet plugged into our movement. And we use it to create a doorway and to create a narrative for people to join us. I was hanging out on the smoking porch with Dustin earlier today, and I'm not a smoker, but the smoking porch is where a lot of cool conversations were happening today, so I was like hanging out there, being a cool kid, and Dustin was saying, what we really need right now is a way to shift the story. We need a way to shift the story that the industry is telling about jobs versus the environment into our story that we're being proactive with. And that really stuck with me. And for me, that's what this is. It's a tool for shifting the story. So how did this come to be? A group of 9 of us from the Beehive Collective, which is an all-volunteer art activist group based in Maine, got together in the spring of 2008 to do a listening project in the Appalachian coal fields, where a ton of work had been going on for centuries, but more recently for decades, to fight strip mining. And we traveled through West Virginia, Virginia, Kentucky, and Tennessee, hosted mostly by the Mountain Justice Network and dozens of grassroots community groups in the region. And we talked to a lot of activists, a lot of students. We did a little bit of like door-to-door kind of stuff too. We talked to anyone who would chat with us about how mountaintop removal coal mining is affecting their lives today, how it's gotten to be this way in the region, and what people are picturing for their vision of the future. And then we took the stories that folks shared with us, and we synthesized them together as that group of 9, and we turned them into scenes and vignettes and metaphors and stories that use plants and animals to explain what it is that's going on with our societies and with our communities. And we chose plants and animals that are native to the Appalachian region, which, as many folks know, is the most biodiverse temperate forests on the entire planet. So we're using this as an opportunity to educate people not only about some of the problems and the challenges and the struggles of the folks, but also about this incredibly rich ecological diversity that's present in this region and why it's so special. And for folks that are geeked on making art and making comics and making cartoons and making art together, you should see me after class and we can talk more about how we use vellum sheets and mind maps and sticky notes and a lot of brain juice to put this thing together. One point I want to lift up that we talked about a bit in the independent media panel today is that we didn't just do this in a vacuum. We used this not just to be a sort of art tool, but to be an organizing tool. So we returned to a lot of the groups and communities that helped provide the initial impetus for making the graphic to ask people if we were getting the story right. So this is a picture of us with a draft version coming back to folks and being like, is this what's up? Did we synthesize what you all said in a way that makes sense as like a meta-narrative? We drew you like a cockroach. Is that cool? Like, what do you think? And people gave us feedback, and we incorporated that feedback to the point where when we finished this juggernaut 3 years after we started it, a lot of folks felt a great deal of ownership over the graphic and continue to use it in their own organizing. And it's something worth continuing to think about as a group. How do we keep transmitting this tool and passing this tool along so people who aren't Beehive Collective members feel empowered to use it? One of the ways we do that is by printing copies of the graphic as paper posters. So you can see us rolling many, many hundreds of them in this slide that we distribute to people for a sliding scale or for free in some areas. And that allows people to become story keepers and storytellers themselves. The other piece of what we do is we travel and do political education with the graphics in this sort of large format banner version. This is actually our small banner. We have one that's twice as big for outside events.
Which is shown on the slide.
Yeah, which is shown on the slide. It's really, really huge. It's like you're walking around inside it. It's really fun. So we're reaching out to not just to impacted communities, not just to activist communities, but we're often invited to do public presentations in universities, high schools, you know, will you come to my birthday party? Sometimes happens. I mean, people invite us to all sorts of things, and we take them up on whatever we can. We're called the Beehive because of this sort of metaphor of cross-pollination, right? We're like bees move units of ecology around. They move DNA around from flower to flower. We're geeked on moving stories around, units of culture from community to community, because that's part of how we build an analysis that moves us forward. And it's like about relationships and stuff, right? Right. Cool. So this is the decoder ring for how to read the poster, because like there's a lot going on in this drawing. We built this graphic to be a timeline that reads from left to right. And it begins over here in this section, which is really looking at the deep history of the Appalachian Mountains. Everything from the formation of coal 350 million years ago, from the bodies of ancient plants whose grandbabies we might see if we go out for a hike today, to the stories of some of the folks that were stewarding this land since time immemorial before the coal industry came to town and the gas industry came to town. So the stories of the indigenous peoples of this land that so often get overlooked when we're focusing our frame really narrowly on who the political owners of the land are today. The second chapter focuses on transitions that happen between this history, which incidentally we try really hard not to idealize, but to try to like pull some grounded lessons from, the transition that starts to happen when the coal industry does come to town. So it's a chapter looking at colonization patterns, land grabs, labor grabs, how these industries amass so much wealth and power, and on whose backs it happens, and also at ways that people have been pushing back and resisting and organizing all along. There's a double-wide chapter that's right in the center that really looks at what it is that's going on today. So there's a giant mine site here at the center of the graphic that shows us community impacts, also the mechanics of mountaintop removal. But this is really focusing on the current moment that we're in And then the whole last third of the poster is resistance and organizing and good news stories. Because, like, we need those, right? This fourth piece is resistance stories. It's ways that different groups are mobilizing and organizing, using different tactics, but also using some unified strategy to push back against this version of the story, to shift this story. And they are holding space for all the critters in the fifth and final chapter, who are working on building and cultivating alternatives. You can also read the graphic from the bottom to the top. So everything that's along the foreground here is microcosms of impact. We've got medicinal plants running all along the foreground. The water and the story of water and water contamination that's so central in the extraction story is happening here also. And Appalachian community impacts. What's going on in people's livelihoods in their homes? When we scale up to the horizon line, we see the bigger systems that this story is a part of. So where's all this coal or gas going? What's the demand? What's it being used to fuel? Who's making the decisions at a political level, at an economic level, that allow these sacrifice zones, like the ones we're experiencing here, to be created? Does that make sense?
Y'all dig?
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Everybody awake?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Woo!
I'd like to have some of the acid that you used to...
No comment. So, when we tell the story as like a full-on storytelling, it typically takes 2 hours is about the minimum for doing a good job. And there's a lot that we can do with the graphic in a short period of time, but honestly, my perspective is that sometimes it just takes a while to get in there emotionally with people to a place where they're willing to be vulnerable enough and open enough to shift. So we won't spend 2 hours with the graphic tonight, but I do just want to point to these questions because this is the narrative arc that we walk people through when we share the graphic in a longer storytelling format. And we find it really useful as a way to kind of build up the narrative to a place where people are willing to go beyond just talking and thinking about the one issue that they're focused on to thinking about the bigger picture. So just to read off what it says, what's going on? What's up with the issue? How did it get to be this way? What's the history that brought us to this moment? So where did the people power go, that these power holders have it, and who's most affected by the current situation? What's the big picture system, and what's the underlying logic that's keeping that in place? How are we fighting back, and what are we building instead? When we talk about what it is that's going on, we usually start by talking about what coal is and how people in the room are connected to it. We find that often, even folks that are versed in some of the politics of coal don't understand its geological history. So I mentioned before these are the grandbaby plants of the plants that died to form coal. They did that during a time when things were incredibly different on this planet, right? The Carboniferous period was like crazy whack. Appalachia wasn't a mountain range. It was a giant inland swamp. And the continents were all in different places. The bacteria that decomposed plants hadn't evolved yet. The atmosphere was way hotter. Right? And we start with that story not just because we're geology geeks, although that's also true, but because it helps us zoom out right off the bat. And it reminds us also that coal, when it's in the ground, has an important role to play in the ecosystem. Right? Coal itself isn't the bad guy in the story. Coal is a water filter that pulls toxins out of water when it's intact in seams inside of mountains. So it's a way, if sort of our dominant question is how do we shift the story, starting in this sort of zoomed out way really helps us do that. And so these graphics are down here in the bottom left-hand corner. And that gives us an opportunity to talk about not just what is coal's role in an ecosystem, but what's up with the ecosystem in Appalachia, period. Right? This place is not only incredibly biodiverse, it provides the headwaters for most of the drinking water of the eastern seaboard. And it's an incredibly special place biologically. At the center of the graphic, we start to look at the mechanics of mountaintop removal. And for some community groups, for some student groups, we spend a lot of time here. because understanding the mechanics of how it works is really central and important and pretty primary to making change. Here we've drawn a drag line at the very center of the graphic. In a lot of our other work, we have these sort of giant monster machine hybrid characters that are shown destroying the landscape. And we didn't draw the drag line as some sort of hybrid monster because we think it's plenty terrifying just the way it is, right? So these things are huge, right? They're like 22 stories tall. They can fit 3 school buses in their scoop bucket. That's like, you know, half the size of this greenhouse. They're just massive. And as you can see from this slide, you know, they're not only destroying the ecological fabric of Appalachia, but also the social fabric. So here it's sort of literally ripping through a community. And that gives us a chance to talk about some of the impacts that people are experiencing, which I know many folks have been focusing on a lot throughout this weekend. So water contamination, air contamination, slurry problems with when coal is washed, the wastewater that gets injected into old underground mines or pumped back up the mountain and stored in enormous unlined earthen dams. Right? The catastrophic accidents and disasters, unnatural disasters that come about when the engineering feats of slurry impoundments don't work out, as they so often don't. And it also gives us a chance to talk about the sort of development model that's being put forward by the coal industry as part of their sort of good news spin on mountaintop removal. A lot of industry folks will say, listen, Appalachia, there's a reason y'all are so poor and have been poor for generations. It's because you don't have any flat land for development. Right? What? Excuse me. Okay.
So we'll take care of the mountains.
We're going to fix that.
We're going to fix that. We got a plan. It's a good plan. Tried and true. Yeah. We're going to, you know, cut down all your hardwood trees and push them down into the valleys where people live and all the fresh water is. We're going to set off a bunch of explosives in the bedrock, push that down into the valleys. And then we got space for Walmart, which, as we all know, is a great recipe for economic development, right?
So golf courses. Don't forget golf courses.
Yeah, right. There.
You want to see a golf course, Mel? Here we go. There's a golf course. That's an elf playing putt putt. Okay? Okay.
Yeah.
There are plants in the audience all throughout. Yeah, okay. But our Walmart's drawn like a bulldozer. It's pushing family-owned businesses down into the mine pit. What's the so there's like the top 3 things that get built on old mountaintop removal sites when anything gets built, which is really, really rare, are Walmarts, golf courses, and what's the third one?
Prisons.
Prisons.
And schools, which are basically prisons.
Here's a scene of a prison and a school. So what's going on in this scene? Who can read this for us? Anybody? She asked us to participate. Anybody? Bueller? No? Nothing? Your brains are all fried from a day of workshops? It's fine.
Is that hell under?
I'm way awake. I had a lot of coffee.
Is that hell under the cemetery?
Yeah. Oof. Well, this isn't going to work at all. There's another bulldozer, and this one's pushing an elementary school down into the mine pit below, and it's pulling in a federal maximum security prison in its wake, right? So there's all these leaked documents from the coal industry that make it clear that they're intentionally trying to depopulate coalfield areas to diminish resistance, diminish their need to do cleanup, right? And one of the major economic development plans for the area is the introduction of new prisons. So there's a ton more that we could say about that, but we're not digging into that right now. We're moving along quickly. In the how did it get to be this way? A lot of people who aren't from sacrifice zones and impacted communities are really surprised to learn that the kinds of impacts that folks, like folks in this community, are experiencing are even possible this close to Washington, D.C. It's the more I travel, the more I see that folks are still surprised to learn about this stuff. And they're like, well, you know, why aren't folks fighting back? Why are folks letting this happen on their land? And we all know that the answer, at least in the case of the coal story, is that in many cases it's not their land. So this chapter, the second chapter, really focuses on 3 things. It focuses on a land grab, on a labor grab, and on stories of resistance, particularly those that are less often told. So stories of prisoner resistance, the resistance of black folks in the mines, and the resistance stories of women. Here we got the West Virginia State Capitol building being constructed on a bed of timber, cotton, and coal, resources extracted from the land of the South that built the political power of the North. And there's this railroad sort of red carpet scenario rolling out the front, and it's kind of causing a bit of a ruckus. It's like knocking over trees and squishing cows and pushing barns out of the way, right? Just talking about how capital first gets introduced into this area, right alongside sort of burgeoning garment industry, which is one of the first industries to sort of come up as part of the Industrial Revolution. This crop shows us a deed dangling off of a barrel of a gun on a fishing hook, attached to a claw that's ripping the surface away from the ground underneath, which is being drilled out by an auger. So what's this about?
The structure of how you look at how land, why 92% of some counties in West Virginia don't own their land, is there was a separation between mineral rights and land rights. So you have people who weren't familiar with coal at all being like, oh, I get to keep my land and you'll pay me for what's underneath it? That makes sense. And they sold their property for pennies on the dollar for actually what it was worth, and then they actually started to mine coal. And you really can't have a coal mine in your land at the same place.
Right. So guys were going around Appalachia like on donkeys 100, 150 years ago, being like, hey, farmer, you're not using the top 6 inches of your land. How's about you sell it to me for 25 cents an acre? Right? When we drew this, we thought this was a historical scene about the separation of surface rights from mineral rights and the sort of manipulations of landmen. It's not a historical scene, right? It's happening right here, right now, today. And that is sort of a dominant lesson I've found from this whole story, is anywhere you look, it's all happening now. These patterns are repeating. Right, it's not just Appalachia, it's not just coal, but those patterns, if we can look at them clearly, give us some lessons for how to move forward. So like Dustin's saying, like over 90% of the land in many county, coal-producing counties is owned by outside landowning interests, usually in the North. Right? And so that's the land grab piece. The labor grab piece is huge too. Right? So this is showing us our version of the historical coal mining town, the company town, which we find is something that's familiar to folks, you know, anywhere from Maine, where there's blueberries harvested, to Detroit auto workers, feel familiar with this scenario. We drew it like a feudal system. There's this castle that's the boss's house, bristling with guns. He's the only guy with running water at the center. He's got these two arms representing the social institutions that he controls, right? One's the church, where he pays the preacher. The other one's the company store, where he fixes the prices on the goods the workers need. Their housing, their clothes, their food, everything. And this doesn't even get into owning the newspapers, owning the police department, owning the banks, right? But because the coal industry set up these towns, they control these towns, and they control the jobs that people can work. And so we see the workers' houses divided from each other, chained to the company with chains of debt, while the train is running out of town, taking the wealth of Appalachia with it, ensuring that the workers stay behind, impoverished, because their wealth has departed this way.
They even control the school board. It's so important.
And so knowing that history is so important for people today to understand, why is the coal industry so entrenched? Why is it so hard for people to speak up? The labor grab extends to prisoners as well. Convict leasing was a major part of how the coal mines were profitable for coal mine owners, right? They were extracting the labor of their workers by paying them poorly, forcing them to work long hours, putting their children into the mines. But these guys didn't even get paid at all, right? So this is our John Henry carpenter ant. He's got the two sledgehammers, right? Sort of icon of human-powered labor. Reminding us that many of the convicts that were leased to work in the mines when other miners would go out on strike were newly emancipated black folks from the South. We got scenes of fighting back. This is a scene about the Battle of Blair Mountain.
Yeah.
I mean, is anyone in the room familiar with the Battle of Blair Mountain?
7,000 miners get turned to them.
7,000? Is that all?
No. 7,000 armed miners.
It's more than than 7,000.
And the U.S. government sent out planes to surveil them so that the company could send the planes to bomb the miners on Blair Mountain.
So this is it's the second largest armed insurrection in the history of the United States. And I was speaking at Slippery Rock University a couple of days ago, and I asked this question, and it was like complete crickets. No one had ever heard of this.
Right.
Uh-huh. I go to schools in West Virginia, and no one has ever heard of this. And that's where it happened. Right? And, I mean, I hear different figures, but a lot of what I hear is like 13, 14,000 miners. I mean, this is a big freaking deal. These guys hijacked trains to get to this massive protest, right? And they coordinated it all by word of mouth. Like, they didn't have internet, they didn't have Facebook, right? It's like unbelievable. And it's being intentionally written out of history. So we do our best to try to tell this story and others when we travel around to places to remind folks that there's so much people's history that they're not learning, and to do that research and that work.
What's that word? Sever?
Solidarity forever.
Forever.
And in case folks aren't familiar, too, there was a massive march to protect Blair Mountain from mountaintop removal mining. There's a permit to mine it currently.
There's five. So yep. When you look at Blair, which is the place I was working for the past 2 years until recently, there's five different permits that affect Blair Mountain. Some are already touching on the mountain itself, but not on the designated battlefield, which is arbitrary and bullshit. A battle of that size doesn't happen on one ridgeline. And on the other side of that community, a community of 50 people, if they get all of it that they want for the Spruce Number 1 permit, on the other side of that community is, it will be the largest mountaintop removal site in the world. The size of it is about the size of Pittsburgh.
Wow. This might be a bit of a divergence, so it's fine if we skip it, but I know a number of people here actually went to the march, and could you give us an update on the situation?
Yeah, okay. On a very quickly, if you heard about the community center that was there, it was taken away from us. It was really shitty. It's a lot of internal politics. If y'all really want to hear about it, you can talk to me after this. But there's still the Blair Mountain Heritage Alliance. Is still, organizers are in the community, and there's an active effort to stop the permits from going through. And also, different campaigns, like the Ramps campaign, that is determined to do everything we can to protect Blair Mountain.
Actually, right now, one of the permits that is on Blair Mountain is open for comment through the West Virginia DEP. So if you go to the Blair Mountain Heritage Alliance website, they'll give you talking points that you can actually write and comment. We know the DEP doesn't do anything, but the more people who speak up against this permit, the more fighting we can do.
And from what I understand, this has been a powerful sort of focal point for organizing, because it brings together the labor history with the current environmental movement in a really powerful way. And those groups have been really, the coal industry has been intentionally trying to polarize those groups at every available juncture, right? So divide and conquer is kind of the name of their game, and getting together and being like, oh, hell no, is kind of the name of our game, which is what's going on in this scene. This is a square dance. It's a celebration. It's a hoedown. Shabbos threw a hoedown not that long ago. Woohoo! Yeah. These are animals famous for their flashy dance moves. So the turkey, bees do this really cute waggle dance when they like find something they're excited about. It looks like this. I'm doing it right now. Okay.
More.
Woodcock, the June bug holding this like mysterious mason jar full of clear liquid. They're celebrating the victories of the United Mine Workers of America. They're celebrating unionization and people coming together despite those divide and conquer tactics. So they've got a flag that says 888. The right to work an 8-hour day, 8 hours for rest, and 8 hours for what you will. They've got a caduceus. That's the name of that medical thing. Did you know that? The like snake with the thing? I just learned that. Celebrating the right to workers' comp, right? The right to have a weekend. The right to have your kids go to school and not have to go to work in the mines. Right? Stuff that miners fought and died for us to have today. And in the bottom left-hand corner, we see a bunch of totally rad women who are organizing across the clotheslines in ways that are maybe less flashy and less public than the dudes in the Blair Mountain scene who are picking up guns, but no less important. Right? The labor of these folks was extracted and exploited too. Right? Imagine if the coal companies had had to pay for childcare and had to cook lunch for all the miners. I mean, they never would have made any money. Right? So these folks are hanging up a bedsheet that says, "Which side are you on?" A reference to the famous union song written by Florence Reese, who was the wife of a union miner. So in our storytelling, we use this as an opportunity to ask people the question, where did all this power go that folks fought so hard to build? And who's most affected in this story? Here we see a continuous mining machine, which can do the work of 10 underground miners, cruising into the scene, undercutting the power of the United Mine Workers of America, despite the best resistance attempts of these characters that have very well-developed resistance mechanisms, the skunk, the farmer, the rattlesnake, and this possum playing possum. And mountaintop removal is the ultimate example of mechanization. Right? A dragline can do the work of about 200 people, and it doesn't need to sleep, and it doesn't need health benefits, and it doesn't need to stay home with its kids if its kids get sick. It certainly doesn't complain about safety violations, and neither can miners who work in the mines these days, because suddenly now there's like 190 guys who are unemployed since the dragline came into play, right? Which means that we're seeing major spikes in black lung incidents. It means that the mines are a lot less safe than they were even a couple decades ago, right? Underground and surface. And that's what we see playing out in this scene that we call the Dance of Hard Choices, where we see a family of Culps's gray tree frogs. Frogs are indicator species who show us that something's wrong in our system. Right? Playing out this really difficult economic dance of different pressures on them while they're being borne down on by these two different coal trucks that represent the different faces of the industry. So on the one hand, we have this coal truck that sort of, we call the Gifts of Coal. It's got this sort of sparkly crest smile, a Santa Claus hat. It's overburdened with gifts and toys, paychecks, and consumer products, trucks, the things that people want and need and get from the coal industry, including community services, Little League, animal rescue, things that might be paid for in other communities by the tax base. And it's squaring off alongside this truck that represents the threats of coal, with these sort of snaggle teeth, overweight, bearing down with spotlights of surveillance on anybody who steps out and organizes. And so these two pressures are working in tandem to make it difficult for people to stand up and speak out. Folks know Larry Gibson in this room?
Yep.
I was giving this presentation the other night, and I started talking about Larry, and it was the first time I had done it since Larry passed away, and I started, like, completely bawling in front of this room of college students. They were like, oh my gosh, she's crazy. But I love to tell Larry's story as somebody who, you know, experienced a lot of physical assault and a lot of repression for speaking out and continued to fight right up until the very end. For folks who aren't familiar with him, you should look him up on YouTube and on Google, because there's lots of great footage of Larry. But, you know, Larry wore a highlighter-colored sweatshirt and a highlighter-colored hat to be as visible as possible in the face of things like being run off the road by coal trucks, being punched out at hearings, having his cabin shut up, having his dog hung. So the repression that people have been facing in this fight is really real, and the bravery is really real too. And not everybody can do that. A lot of folks who live here, most folks who live here, have family in the coal industry. This is Miner Frog detonating the explosives that are blowing up the mountain out behind his house. He's getting his paycheck from the coal company, and he goes home at the end of the week and he's not doing so great, right? He's like maybe slipped a disc in his back, probably got respiratory illness from breathing in coal dust all day long, and his little tadpole, she's looking completely freaked out because she's pouring the water out of the tap and it's coming out black, which it shouldn't be. And her mama's gardening and she's looking with dismay at all of these tomatoes and these green beans that are coming up out of the ground looking like zombies. And this is a reference to some of our friends in Prenter, West Virginia, who told us, you know, they started blasting up behind our house a couple of years back, and suddenly all of the stuff that we were growing in our garden rotted. All the vegetables we put up for winter in cans rotted in their jars. We didn't forget how to can. It's our water that's bad. And so everybody in the family is sick, and they do what you do when you're sick. They go to visit the doctor, who's depicted as this, like, really well-endorsed pharmaceutical jackass character. Who's getting this sort of sweaty wad of cash from Minor Frog. He's got, you know, Bayer, Purdue, Pfizer, all of these pharmaceutical companies that are giving doctors massive kickbacks to overprescribe highly addictive pain medication to a really vulnerable population. Central Appalachian counties have some of the highest rates of prescription drug abuse of anywhere in the country, and people said to us, you know, there's two kinds of flooding happening in our community. There's the physical destruction and the sort of loss of land, and there's this sort of community destruction that's happening with manufactured addiction that's coming from these companies. And so at the end of the day, Minor Frog's just got a couple of coins left in his flipper. He's putting his hard hat back on because he knows he's got to keep sort of sticking in with this cycle. He's got to go back to work to maintain his health insurance, to even take care of his family that's getting sick from the job he's doing. Right? He's having to blow up the place that he loves, that his family's been from for generations, in order to be able to stay here. And Tadpole's scratching her head. She's like, what am I supposed to do? I'm like a teenager. I just sprouted these legs. Like, I feel really awkward. And I'm looking down the path, and I'm like, am I following my father in his footsteps? Like, is there even going to be a job for me here? Or am I going to follow this really well-trodden path out of town and go to the city like so many young people have had to do? Do we stay or do we go? And it's not a choice that anybody should have to make in that way. For me, this scene is really useful in doing that frame shifting that we were talking about the jobs versus the environment frame, right? Because when we take a step back, it's not environmentalists that are putting miners out of work, right? It's the coal industry that's mechanizing the mines and making it so very difficult for people in situations like this. I know I'm going fast. If we had like 4 hours, we would just talk about all of this stuff. But I'm going to just sort of keep on going.
You're doing great.
So yeah, that you kind of get the whole picture, even if it's not as deep as it might be. Cool. Speaking of the whole picture, what is the big picture? Who's responsible for the plight of Minor Frog? Is it consumers of coal? People who turn on the light switch and burn coal for electricity? Is it the government? Is it the corporations? Who's in charge here? What's going on? We drew this scene that's running all along the horizon line to try to help people identify not just what are the impacts and not just what's the issue, but what's the system that's allowing this to happen. Not only allowing it, dependent on it happening. Some of us call that system capitalism. I don't usually say that when I'm like talking to college students or community groups. You know, we just say, what's the economy? What's the materials economy? Where's this coal going? Right? Coal is used to produce over 50% of the electricity in the United States. It's used in manufacturing of most consumer products because it's so cheap and abundant. It's used to make concrete. It's used to make steel. So, like, what in our world is made out of concrete, electricity, steel, and or cheap plastic crap?
Cities.
Everything! Right? So we're all connected. This is our power plant scene. It looks kind of like a sort of souped-up tentacular extraction machine that made out with a train. We don't really know. There's a lot going on. But it's kind of like, cruising into the scene. It's this train of progress. It's got all these arms gobbling up resources. Water, trees, land, jobs. Right? It's sucking them into its combustion belly. It's burning them and churning them up. And it's pulling in behind it this train of factories, right, that are vanishing to this, what we call an art vanishing point on the horizon, right? Which represents a way. It represents globalization. It reminds us that most of the stuff that all these fossil fuels are being used to make isn't even made here anymore, right? A lot of this coal is being shipped to China, most of it. Well, we're importing fossil fuels. It's wild. And if you went down the rabbit hole of this, you might fall into one of our other Beehive posters about globalization, and you're welcome to do that on your own time, but we're not going to go there right now because it's just way too much. So back we come, like all of these other consumer products that are swirling in on this high-flying, infinity-shaped conveyor belt. And they end up here at what we like to call the Temple of Conspicuous Consumption. It's kind of like a layer cake of delightfulness. We've got a gated community on the bottom rung with all these McMansions. They've got every light on in the house, but they've got solar panels. They're so green. And above them, we got a bunch of hybrid SUVs that are plugged into the grid. Above that, a giant mall with a green leaf band-aid, TM, on it. It says consume, and the whole thing is illuminated with compact fluorescent light bulbs. So this is our moment to talk with folks about greenwashing, to talk with folks who maybe don't live in an impacted community and aren't going to become solidarity activists full-time overnight, about the way that their compassion is being commodified, the way that their good intentions are being channeled into just buying different stuff, or being blamed for the problem. People are being told, it's your fault. Your showers are too long. You didn't ride your bicycle enough. You didn't have the right Energy Star appliance. Right? If I were to ride my bicycle every single day for the rest of my life, I would not save as much fossil fuels as are used in a single test flight of a jet fighter plane. And that's not to say I shouldn't do it. Right? It's good for me. It's good for the world. It's a great example. It gets me in the right headspace to think about solutions. And it's not enough. Right? And we don't get to vote on that shit. And so to complete the cycle, we've got this waste stream. Right? We've got this poop chute coming out of this mall, reminding us that our stuff is built to break. Right? The stuff that's in this pile isn't even that old. Okay, that computer monitor is pretty old. But most of it is not that old, right? There's no plan about what to do, even with the clean green stuff, even with the iPods that look like they're not powered by coal or gas. They are, right? And they're toxic. They're so toxic that we have to, like, bury them under the ground so they don't make us sick. And so the story, in the case of Appalachia, we're literally taking these ancient, squishy, green, wet grandma mountains and chewing them up and turning them into mountains of trash. Like, literally a one-for-one. Right? Which is what makes us think of this section of the poster as not a life cycle, but a death cycle. And it's not even a cycle, it's a one-way street. It's a linear extractive system where waste doesn't turn back into food. Right? And that's not the way that nature works. But this is the way that nature works. This is the scene we call the smackdown, or the climate change spiral of doom, right?
Don't act too excited.
Really caffeinated. In honesty, though, it's like, how do you have this conversation with people? How do you talk about it without being a major downer and having people get so paralyzed that they're like, I just need to read Harry Potter and, like, not talk to you anymore? Like, how do you go there? And also, how do you not go there? Right? It's so connected. For me, being able to contrast that linear system where waste doesn't turn back into food with this kind of cycle is really important. So we know when we put tons of heat into the atmosphere, it goes into the ocean and hurricanes pick it up. Like, we're gonna have more and more Katrinas and Sandys as things go. And even if we were to stop all point source pollution today, like, put a stopper in each of those smokestacks there, like, now, we'd still have at least 30 years of catastrophic climate change coming down the pipe, like, for sure. And all the Pentagon's projections, public image to the contrary, assume catastrophic climate change is a given. And so the conversation that we're trying to have with folks is not, you know, how do we stop climate change, because it's too late for that. It's about recognizing that these power holders up here, the coal industry, the oil and gas industry, they see the writing on the wall, too. You know, they're looking for ways to capitalize on the crises that they're manufacturing every day. They are. They totally are. Right? And so how are we using this as a moment of opportunity to recognize that business as usual is not actually possible anymore? Right? Whether you are into gas or against it, you're into coal or against it, this is coming, and we gotta make plans. And it's already here in a lot of our communities, right? So as you can imagine, for a lot of folks, getting kind of into some of that stuff brings up a lot of questions and a lot of concerns. At Slippery Rock, there was a kid who, in the middle of the show, was like, but wait a minute, this is the foundation our country was built on. We need to make sacrifices. I mean, really.
We're all gonna die.
He was like, it's not negotiable. You know, this is how we got to be here, and the sacrifices have been worth it. And by the time we got to this part, he was like, I need you to tell me some good news, because this is really scary, and I'm not going to be able to sleep tonight. Like, we've made some progress, you know? But then it's on us to tell people some good news and give them a way to plug in. And what I find is really useful is not just talking about the way the system is structured, but the way the logic is structured. Because for me, I grew up inside the system. I've always bought my food at the grocery store. I've always bought my products from away. I've always been driven around in cars my whole life, right? So it's sort of hard to imagine what does something beyond a fossil fuel dependent reality even look like or feel like or taste like. I can't even picture that. It's hard. But the truth is, that's a system that was made by people. And it was made by people not that long ago. Like a couple of hundred years we've been doing that crazy treadmill. And people have been doing other stuff for a lot longer than that. Right? Sorry, this slide's really fuzzy. I couldn't find a better crop. But way up here, you all see that? There's this cute little like NASA rocket thing with a Westward Ho wagon propped on top of it, an American flag shooting off to Mars to be colonized by Newt Gingrich, I think. Y'all heard the term manifest destiny before?
Yeah.
Was that in your high school history books?
Yeah.
What's manifest destiny?
It's our God-given right to colonize.
To rule.
To expand.
Consume.
To kill brown people. Let's be real, y'all.
Let's be real, y'all. Take over. Well, they weren't using the land right, Dustin. Right? That's the logic. Right? The people that were here before, they're in the way. They don't count. It's not just our privilege to take over. It's our God-given obligation to take over. Right? And that logic undergirdles a lot of this story. So way over in the upper left, there's this giant eastern hemlock tree. And there are all of these European starlings kicking it there. They're actually swarming over from Europe. And they're crash landing in the boughs of the tree where native songbirds have made their nests. And some of them are bringing over sort of a complicated mixed bag of stuff. They've got these gifts and also curses. Things like culture and agriculture, music, religion, military power. The next generation. I don't have a crop of it, but one of them has shackles on her feet that are broken, reminding us that a lot of the European folks that came to this part of the world, they came escaping persecution and oppression elsewhere, looking for a better life. But we also see that they all were carrying a story inside of themselves, this manifest destiny story that says that the world is ours for the taking. And that story starts to get pretty weird when it runs into other people who already live there, which is what's going on here. So European starlings are really invasive birds. These ones are kicking native songbirds out of their nests, whether through just military might. The second one is a clergy member stealing the pileated woodpecker's baby, which is a reference to settlement schools and boarding schools, native youth being rounded up and forced to become Christianized, to speak only English, often sexually abused in the schools where they were placed. And often, you know, even really recently as 50 years ago in Maine and Alaska and other places. And finally, this bird carrying a sort of flag blanket hybrid with a skull and crossbones on it, draping it across another bird who looks really sick, in this case with smallpox. And so a reminder of these sort of early cases of biopiracy and biowarfare. And finally, down in the lower left, there's a scene of native folks represented by Cherokee clan animals who are facing off with the U.S. government, resisting the Indian Removal Act, resisting being put on a forced march to Indian country in Oklahoma, which came to be known as the Trail of Tears. And there were about 15,000 people that were put on this march in 1838 in the winter without enough clothes or food, and about a third of them died on the way. And all of that is to say that the stuff that's happening here now, it ain't the first time. And we know that, right? These are patterns that are repeating over and over again. And in a lot of ways, until we look squarely at this history and recognize how much of a pattern it is and how much this trauma isn't yet healed for us as a whole society, we're not going to be able to move forward. This is my favorite scene in the poster. It's a scene of the most endangered species in the whole story, who've come from really different communities. They've come from the air, like the bat, or the Virginia big-eared bat and the bee, endangered from colony collapse disorder. They've come from the water, they've come from the land, and they've come together in the root system of a tree that's collapsed, not because it got blown up on a mountaintop removal site, but because the air is toxic and the soil is toxic and the whole darn system is toxic. Right? Not just if they stop mountaintop removal tomorrow, they're still really screwed. Right? And so they're trying to strategize together about not how do we just fight our own issues, but how do we actually come together and build a movement that goes on the offensive and isn't always on the defensive of our lands. So they're looking at their watershed map. They're looking at the resources that unite them. They're drawing mind maps and charts and graphs. They're doing community research projects. That's what all the books are about, right? They're using cultural work and songs and stories to share their experiences and build strategy and power. And because they're the most impacted people, because they are the front lines, because they're folks like Maggie, they're setting the strategy for everybody else in this fourth section who's really taking a cue from them about how to engage and how to fight back. So right next door, there's this swarm of pollinator species that represent community organizers. And they're putting all of these strategies into operation. They're organizing to have a march. They're doing a lot of different stuff. They recognize that they have to be really loud to be heard over all of these generations of intentional silencing in their communities. So they're having this march on Washington, like Appalachia Rising, or Ed Wiley's Pennies for Promise march. They're asking for, they're demanding Coalfield citizens' rights. And of course, the petition is signed with paw prints, not with signatures, because animals can't hold pens, yada, yada, yada. This one's spray painting a sign that says, no jobs on a dead planet. Reminding us, again, that this frame about jobs versus the environment is totally quack. We feel like it's really important as this, like, weird hybrid documentary illustration thing that we do, that we help not just talk about bad news, but lift up resistance stories that are powerful and successful. So these are some moths that represent the Dustbuster Sisters in Sylvester, West Virginia. This couple of grannies who were struggling like crazy to get a giant mountain of coal covered up in their community and to fight coal dust contamination in their houses. And they couldn't get anybody to listen to them. And so for years, they would every day take a Kleenex and wipe the inside windowsill of their houses. And all this coal dust would come off, and they'd put that hanky into a plastic bag, so that's not a moldy sandwich, that's a coal-covered handkerchief. And over the years, they built up enough evidence to actually win a class action lawsuit against Massey, which was at the time the most powerful coal company in southern West Virginia. Yes! It's good news!
Can we celebrate the few victories we have?
Can we celebrate the few victories? It's very exciting. And they're wielding a dustbuster in the graphic. That was an easy one. This is just a really cute bat that I like a lot. And these folks know that they're not going to do it by themselves. Right? Very much like Maggie, they're calling in folks from other communities to come and lend a hand and bring their skills and tools. Because they recognize that they don't have to reinvent the wheel. Right? A lot of our communities have been struggling for a really long time, and there's a lot that we can learn from each other. In this case, the solidarity activists that are coming in are represented by a tortoise and a hare. Y'all familiar with the story of the tortoise and the hare?
Yeah.
So different speeds of working. So the hare has this graduation cap on. She's like, late, late, late for a very important date. She's talking on the cell phone. She's like, Grandma, Grandpa, better turn on the TV. I'm about to be on it. I'm locking down to some stuff. Right, she's got a U-lock on her hip. This sort of pre-manufactured raised fist sign, just like mandatory in all leftist propaganda. You have a raised fist. You got that covered? Don't worry. Good, check. And then the tortoise, who's got a really different agenda, right? He's coming in with this big backpack with a beehive patch on it. He's going to stay for a while. He's got this documentary camera and this carrot brand laptop. What? He's coming in to maybe live in the community and recognize that you know, transformative change often doesn't happen overnight. You might have to stay for like a year or 2 years or 3 years to build trust and build relationships, especially in rural places where folks have been fighting for so long that their faith and trust and resistance might be kind of shattered, might be kind of rough right now. Yeah. And this isn't to say one way or the other flashy action jumping or long-term organizing is better. It's just to recognize that we have to know our roles and know our place and name what it is that we're doing and how we're doing it. And most importantly, these guys are taking their cue from this other hair down at the bottom who's like waving these air traffic controller wands. Y'all see her?
Mm-hmm.
Yes? And she's got this monarch butterfly's whispering into her ear. He's like proboscis to the ear. Saying, this is where these folks can plug in. He's from the community. Right? So we're ensuring that these folks aren't crash landing in a way that's taken over or making a mess, but that they're actually standing in solidarity with people. And this tortoise has been plugged into water testing. Shall I talk about water testing this weekend? Is that a thing that got brought up? Right. So this has been a way that especially students, people who know something about biochemistry, not me, but other people, have been able to successfully support the organizing that's going on. We got a scene of this raccoon who reminds us that not all resistance is flashy in public, especially for folks who would be endangering their livelihoods or those of others by speaking out. Right? So a lot of the Appalachian Mountains have been used as commons for a really long time, and now the coal industry wants to put up barbed wire fence and say, you can't hunt here and you can't fish here. Folks just continuing to use the land the way that they always have to make a livelihood is a really important form of resistance. I remember talking with one guy who was like, yep, I put my hunting stand up and they chop it down. And I put my hunting stand up and they chop it down. And I put my hunting stand up and they chop it down. And we just do this dance the entire season and I don't quit. It's real, right?
Cool.
Yeah. In our story, in our picture, there's roles for people who don't live in the coal fields, too. Really important roles. This millipede is doing something we call paper wrenching. Are you all familiar with monkey wrenching? Like industrial sabotage, throw a wrench in the gears? Okay. Well, she's doing that with the laws that are on the books that regulate mountaintop removal, which is unfortunately legal. And the laws exist to protect communities. They're badly enforced and they don't do a good job, but they do exist. And so she's looking at the Surface Mining Control and Reclamation Act, the Clean Air Act, the Clean Water Act, valley fill permits. She's turning all of this stuff into paper airplanes that she's chucking at this new clean coal-fired power plant that's cruising into the scene.
Hmm.
You can tell it's clean coal because of the scrubby bubbles on the bottom. The stuff that she's throwing is missing its mark. It's being paper shredded by the coal plant into a ticker tape parade that it's throwing for itself. But some of these airplanes are actually successful. They're gumming up the gears of this machine. Right? They're buying time. These folks, they're like, it's death by a thousand paper cuts. We're exhausting administrative capacities. It's like, Matt Landon, you're hilarious. They're buying time for these community activists on the ground who are doing what? Ah, right? Yeah, they're having a blockade. They're not letting this coal truck into their community.
That's us.
That's us. It's all us.
Yay.
And these folks are in a low-income community of color in the drawing. Right? They're in an urban community where this coal plant is being built. They're reminding us that all of these extraction struggles are rural and urban. Right? And they're saying, hey, psst, clean coal is a dirty lie. It doesn't exist. It's science fiction. We want to think about power in a different way. We want to think about community power, not just renewables versus fossil fuels. Right? We want to think about people power. Way up at the top of the scene, there's this like carnival-esque scenario going on. There's a lot of moving parts to this scene. But basically, we're seeing power holders on the edge of the graphic all sort of hanging out at the intersection of Wall Street and Capitol Hill. And there are these moth characters kind of kicking it next to this ATM of Bank of America and Citigroup. They're shining a light on who some of the funders and financiers are of these practices. It costs a lot of money to get a drag line operational. They were like, most people don't live near a frack pad or near a mountaintop removal site, but pretty much everybody in the United States has a Bank of America branch somewhere nearby. What if we got everyday people to just close their bank accounts with these banks that fund this stuff? then they might actually pay attention. This divestment as a strategy. And they've been really successful at getting some of the banks to sign off on this stuff. It's like they're kind of saying they'll do it, and then they don't really do it. It's the fight's not over, but the tactic continues to be really useful. And finally, with this section of the poster, we see some of these some of the other players that are getting in on trying to come up with solutions. So have you all seen like used car dealerships, the like wacky, wavy, inflatable tube men thing that are going on here? So these represent some of the big green organizations that aren't always as accountable as we'd like them to be to community-based groups. Groups like the Natural Resources Defense Council or the Nature Conservancy, reminding us that our movements are complex, right? So these guys are full of hot air. They bend over backwards to put their rubber stamp of approval on legislation coming out of Washington. They're collecting lots of donations. They've got tote bags. Environmentalists love tote bags. This is a hard thing to do quickly and do justice to. If you want to hear the backstory on this, check me later. But the point being that they're all of these folks, the big greens, the big banks, and the big government folks, are different places where pressure can be applied. So a big part of what we're saying to folks when we're out on tour is don't listen to those Al Gores of the world that tell you the only change you can make is to put more air in your tires and buy different stuff. Right? Not just your consumer dollars, but all of these points of intervention are necessary. And finally, we've got this platter of false solutions in this scene that shows us some of the different things that these guys are proposing as possible alternatives to fossil fuels. Right? So we've got things like ethanol, biomass, clean coal, big hydro, big wind, big solar, ethanol, liquefied natural gas, and nuclear, none of which can possibly replace coal safely or effectively. Right? There's no silver bullet solution to our energy crisis. So what are we building instead? A lot of the scenes in the first chapter of the poster remind us that it's not necessarily always going to be about inventing new stuff or innovating new stuff. The big part of the work that we have cut out for us right now is just to stop blowing up some of the people who actually know how to live in a sustainable way on a finite planet. Right? And that means Appalachian folks who've been, you know, canning and burning wood and, you know, living in a sustainable way for an awfully long time. It also means people other places on the planet who don't depend on fossil fuels for their livelihood. Some leaders from an indigenous community in Colombia came up to Kentucky a couple of years ago to address audiences there, and they were saying, you know, we're being displaced for the largest open pit coal mine in the world, in the Guajira region of Colombia. And it's all for electricity, but we've never used electricity, ever. When, you know, the sun goes down, we go to bed. When the sun comes up, we get up. We built our houses in a smart way so they're cool in the summer and warm when it's cold. And, you know, when it's dark outside, we're not lost. We're not confused about who we are. We know what our place in the world is. And we know who our family is. We know who our people are, too. You know, we belong where we live. And we don't really understand why y'all need to have 24-hour waffle houses and, like, be on your iPods at all hours of the night. Like, we're confused, and you don't seem that happy. What's going on? You know? So, you know, these things might seem fanciful, but they're sustainable practices that actually make sense today. These are flat-spired three-toothed land snails who are growing a garden of corn, beans, and squash, the three sisters that have sustained people in this hemisphere for generations. Next to them, there's some beavers who are like the heavy industrialists of the forest, changing their landscape, not having an impact, but having a positive impact. They're creating a dam that creates fish habitat that help feed and sustain this heron. Meanwhile, these squirrels down at the bottom of the graphic are digging in the leaf litter. They're planting seeds that will become the next generation of the forest. They're burying their dead and planting new seeds, just sort of as an emblem and a reminder about the importance of living in a cyclical way. And so all the characters in the last chapter of the poster are drawing their inspiration from that first chunk. They're putting those practices or those ideas into practice. These are seven generations of women salamanders who are doing some of the cleanup that's going to be required to take care of the damage that's already happened because of these extractive industries and sacrifice zones. So there's a grandma or a great grandma teaching this expectant mother about medicinal herbs. She looks a little bit like Jabba the Hutt, but that's how you draw an old salamander. These folks are doing bioremediation. They're planting oyster mushrooms, which are powerful enough to break down petrochemicals and cattails, while this mother bathes her baby in fresh water, representing an appropriate use of water rather than washing coal or fracking a frack well. And it's all being tied together by this sort of menopausal age salamander who's weaving this mat that unites all of these folks together. It's a testament to family and the importance of working where you're at and intergenerationality. There are a lot of scenes of changing land use in this part of the graphic. This is an organic garden where there's a bunch of earthworms and maggots who are busily composting. And like, how often do maggots get to be the heroes of anything? Almost never. We're so stoked for them. And they've got all of this old mining equipment, these buckets and these tires that they're planting new seeds in. They're reminding us that really we're not talking about a contrast between fossil fuels and renewable energy. We're talking about rethinking the whole way that we do everything on this planet. Right? So it's soil, not oil. It's building our land use patterns in ways that are sane and sensible, and eating food that comes from closer to home. These folks are harvesting and saving seeds and collecting rainwater, because the groundwater is not going to be drinkable in this part of the world for an awfully long time. And they're sharing the harvest of what they've grown with folks that still live in urban areas through things like community-supported agriculture or a community-supported kitchen, where folks can not just put up food for the winter, but actually create value-added products that diversify the economy. So the grip, the vice grip of the coal industry or of the oil and gas industry isn't so intense.
That's really cute.
Cute? When Obama was getting elected the first time, we made a patch that says, yes, we can. Not because we're into that, but because that's the can that's actually real. Won't change, whatever. Anyway, okay. In this section of the poster, there are folks living in urban areas, right? This isn't meant to be like, someday we're all going to go back to the land and like wear clothes made out of a deer and eat mud. Like, some people do that. Some people look really good doing that, and it's very romantic, but it's not really realistic for everybody. Certainly we need to change our relationship to the land, but that doesn't always mean that we need to live in a rural place. These are paper wasps, who in some of our other graphics are sort of bad guy consumers, and we brought them back in this poster to be consumers who've gotten their act together. They're starting to work as producers and live collectively to minimize the impact that they're having. They've started a cooperative business, actually. And unlike Dustin's dream, they live and work in the same place. They're paper wasps, so it's a print collective. Sorry, it's true. So they're doing this sort of productive economic work. They're also taking sustainability measures where they live. They're planting a rooftop garden. They're retrofitting their home to make it more efficient. And they're sharing in the domestic labor of their small community as well. Doing the dishes, so important. Right? And they're valuing everybody's labor and everybody's time equally. They're also using old stuff in this part of the poster. Not everything here is new, right? Maybe they're moving into a building that just needs some tender, loving care and fixing it up slowly with what they have lying around. All the electricity in this part of the poster is being generated locally and small scale, like this little hydro dam that's being fixed by the crawdad. And this electricity grid that's being dismantled by these birds, just reminding us about how inefficient it is to ship electricity all over the country, right? About two-thirds of all the electricity generated in a coal-fired power plant is lost by the time it gets to the light bulb, just because the grid's so darn inefficient, right? So there's harm reduction stuff that can happen.
Two-thirds, yeah.
Harm reduction stuff that can happen while we're trying to strategize about what it is that we do want. So this dismantling work is happening with the grid. It's also happening with the fences dividing up people's properties, a reference to some of the land trust projects that people are starting, where they're figuring out ways to do democratic governance and own their land in common to protect it from these outside interests, right? Getting really creative. Those birds that I talked about before that were looking for a better home, they're mirrored by these homecoming birds that are returning to their rural place to make a go at sticking it out there. There's a grandma bird on the right-hand side who's saying, welcome home. She's gathering them up into a hug. A lot of the elder folks that we talked to making this poster, we said, you know, what gives you hope? And this guy from Kentuckians for the Commonwealth said, you know, I will feel hopeful when the young people in my community don't have to leave. When they feel like there's a future here and a livelihood for them here and they can stay. And y'all are talking to me about an energy crisis, and I don't know, like, all the young people in our community are, like, or a lot of them are, they're unemployed, they're sitting at home, they're on drugs, they're playing video games. Like, what about their energy? Like, can we think about energy in a more creative way? What about people energy? Right? That's what we really need. It's living energy. So these are queer birds that have gone to the city to, like, get some community and be in a place where their identity is accepted. Right? These are birds that have gone to the city. This, like, nurse bird is, like, the smartest bird in the universe. She's, like, a doctor and a dentist and an optometrist all at the same time. Right? They're coming back with skills and tools. And they're coming back to reroot themselves where they belong. Right? They're committing to a place. And they're reclaiming their own stories, which is what's happening here, too. So these animals are a continuation of the Trail of Tears. These are native characters coming back and reminding us that real land reclamation means honoring native land rights, recognizing, you know, this land is your land, but this land is really these folks' land, for serious. And we got to figure out ways that we can honor that story and heal some of those wounds. Finally, we've got a possum here dangling out of the tree doing independent media and community radio work. Rust Belt Radio, woo-hoo! Reference to Apple Shop, this totally rad media-generating space in Whitesburg, Kentucky that trains up young folks in storytelling and story gathering and story transmission, because reclaiming how we tell the story and how we represent is a huge piece of the puzzle. Finally, I mentioned the hemlock trees before. There's two of them. Did you notice? There's this one, and then there's this one. And the story of the hemlock tree is really sad. I don't know if folks are familiar with this, but the eastern hemlock trees are really sick right now with this disease called the woolly adelgid, which I guess is looks a bit like this, these sort of cotton ball-like smallpox-looking things on it. And there's, you know, smarty-pants academics all over the place who are trying to figure out how to save the eastern hemlock and ways to, like, inoculate and treat trees that aren't yet sick, but so far they haven't come up with a solution. And so the second time that we see the hemlock tree, it looks like it's dead, because that's looking like it's probably the way that it's going to go for this tree. But down below there's a wasp who's harvesting a mushroom, a fungus, off of the body of the tree, and this is the hemlock reishi mushroom, which only grows on dead hemlock trees. So while these hemlocks have been dying all over the region, there's been this huge proliferation of hemlock reishi, which happens to be a really powerful medicine for heavy metal poisoning and liver toxicity, which happens to be exactly what people in this region need because of the contamination of the water. And I share that story not to be like, don't worry, Mother Nature's got it. Let's just go home. Eat bonbons. We're fine, right? Obviously not. But more just to say that that's cyclical stuff. The fact that nature abhors a linear extractive system and wants all waste to be food, the fact that the plants and animals want things to heal too is really real, you know? And not in like a woo way, but in a like, if we can make some space for things to come back, they want to come back, right? There's like hundreds of wolves in Chernobyl right now that are doing great. You know, they're slightly radioactive, but they're doing okay. Like, I know that sounds like sort of twisted hope, but it's really true that, like, this planet is freaking fierce and can heal in majorly amazing and magical and sort of unforeseen ways, right? And so we don't have to fix everything. We got to make space for it to grow back. And one of the ways that I find really useful to sort of imagine how that works is to do a magic trick. Do you all want to see a magic trick?
Yeah.
Okay. I don't have a hat. I don't have a rabbit. I hope you're not disappointed. So we're called the Beehive Collective. We're sometimes also called the Space Hog Collective. We make really big stuff, and we demand a lot of wall space from people. And we also really recognized with this project that we wanted to make a tool that was useful to people outside the coal fields, but also to people who live in a place where their backyard looks a lot like this. And if your backyard looks a lot like this, you might not want to have a picture of it on your wall all day, every day. And so we came up with this mechanism that allows us to kind of take this linear extractive system that we're looking at and take this bad news that's going on in this graphic, take this really destructive scene of a mine pit that's at the center, and take this narrative of history that's so distorted and so problematic and put it away on days when we just don't want to look at that and we want to think about what we're inspired by instead. And so we made the graphic a folding poster. Wait, I have an animation. That stitches together this first section of the graphic with the fifth section. And when we do that, we're actually putting the mountain holler back together. We're putting the watershed back together. And we're also reinstating the cycles of time. We're saying, straight line, I don't think so. The past and the future are connected, right? We gotta reach back to reach forward. Time just don't go in a straight line. That's just not how it works. So we're linking up things like the folks growing food with the folks harvesting food. We're linking up the folks being displaced in the Trail of Tears with these folks coming home on the longest walk to reclaim their land rights. And we've even linked up these guys in the very center who are playing the ancestor instruments of mountain instruments, things like the gourded African instrument that became the banjo. They're hooking up with these sort of punk rock hillbilly folks from today. And yeah, that might be sort of like Nina Simone in the center. And they're having this like magical intergalactic hoedown moment where all of these sounds from all over the place are harmonizing and building the future, and it's extremely delightful. That's what I brought to share with you. I have paper copies of this poster if people want to take this home and think about it more, look at it more, look for Waldo, whatever. There are little handouts too, like little storybooks that go with it. And people throw us a donation for these a lot because we're volunteers and we're broke, and that's awesome. And if you don't have it, we'd rather you have a poster than not have a poster, like by far. And if you work in a community space, if you've got a neighbor who needs to see this story, if you hang out with kids, take two, take three, there's more under the table. Like, they're teaching tools, and we want y'all to have them, so please do that. And if you want to geek out with me about ways to use some of the tools that we use to make this in your community, you want to make something, come chat with me, because I'm hanging out in Pittsburgh now, and I don't have a job, so that'd be really fun. Ta-da! Yeah!